Dobrodošli. With us this evening, prijatelji moji, two of four, Mlada Srbadija, these kids. You're listening to a live recording of Mlada Srbadija. Oh yeah. Hit the ball. Mlada Srbadija. Srbadija. Actually, that was our opening for this feature of Got Time. Prijatelji moji, još jednom, dobro večer, dobrodošli. and welcome to another episode of Got Time. This evening, we continue on the history of Chicago Serbian music. We've talked to Danny Danilovic of the United Serbs. We've talked to Orchestra Mladost. And now we're going back in time. Tonight, we are joined by Vinko Mančić and Nick Tarajlo. Znači, prijatelji moji, members of what you might remember as Mlada Srbadija. Right there.
Yikes.
Dobro veče and dobro došli, guys. How are you doing?
We're doing okay. Thank you, Spaz, for doing this. This is great, man. We're excited.
We're like Stara Srbadija now, you know?
Yeah, buddy. Yeah, you got that right.
Don't worry, Mlados got the same commentary, you know? Status doesn't matter. But what it is a little piece of history and another era of music where you were able to carry the baton another decade, from what I understand. So let's do some introductions. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to go ahead and introduce Nick Tarajlo.
Hello.
Nick, you want to wave? Bro. Nick Tarajlo. And to the right is Vinko Mančić. Vinko.
Hello.
Vinko is still playing, as far as I know, with the Srbadija group, Orchestra Srbadija. Jel tako?
That's correct.
And Nick, I hear you still play here and there with Tamburashi. Is that the case?
Right. I started playing Tambura years ago, and Tommy talked me into playing with him for just a few jobs, and that lasted a long way. So then I went back to Tambura afterward.
Hey, nothing wrong with Tambura, I promise you that. So, all right, Vinko, I got you here. I got some information on you. We talked a little bit before this. You know, I've only been aware of Mlada Srbadija recently, and that was especially talking to Danny Danilovic. And Mladost, whose name, Mlada Srbadija comes up in both interviews. And now I want to say, well, Vinko, you're from Northwest Indiana, yes?
That's correct.
Tell me, where were you born?
Born and raised in the harbor, man. East Chicago, Indiana. The harbor.
The harbor.
Nick, where were you born?
Detroit, Michigan.
Ne priče.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah.
How did you get into Northwest Indiana?
My dad was born in Gary.
Got it.
And came back to his hometown with my mom and me and my sister.
Bro. So, all right. Now, let's talk about this. Growing up, Vinko, you went to the Harbor EC St. George in the Harbor, right?
That's correct.
And Nick, you ultimately belong to what parish?
St. Elia in Maryville.
In Maryville. Ooh, Feds and Rascals together again.
Well, we started at St. Sava's. I was in the first St. Sava Tambura group. But then, of course, when things went the way they did, we went to St. Elia.
So let's talk about this. And Nick, I hear you come a little bit later in the group, not necessarily immediately the first initial group of Mlada Srbadija. Vinko, since you got the 411 on this, tell me a little bit about the Mlada Srbadija original crew. Who did that consist of?
Well, originally, prior to even me joining, there was Tommy Andrejic, who is my brother-in-law, and he was the accordion player. Mm-hmm. Then you had Lubisha Tanasković, who's also an accordion player.
Okay.
Him and Tommy started playing together, seeing how that was going to work out. So they started playing. They realized after about a month or so, yeah, this is going to work. So they wanted to get a guitar player, and that's when Ned Pokrajec came into the picture.
Okay.
It was really them three. This is 1969 we're talking about now.
1969.
That's what I'm, time ago.
So Mlada Srbadija is formed in 1969, ladies and gentlemen. And that means this right here.
Till my fingers bled, was the summer of 69.
Yeah.
Me and some guys from school.
Isn't this the truth?
Had a band every time,
the truth,
real hard.
Yeah.
Yeah, buddy.
Jody
got so perfect.
So summer of 69. Was it summer? That would have been great if it was.
Yeah, it's the summer, brother. That's what I came into the picture.
All right.
So they're rehearsing. Them three are playing. You know, they figure out two accordions are working good.
Okay.
And they got the guitar player. And it's like, okay. We feel this is going to work. And they figure out, yeah, I guess we got to get a drummer. Okay. So lo and behold, this is a good story. And in fact, probably every Serbian in the world came to, which is, you know, Sonja and Tommy's dad, what would have been my father-in-law, Serbo Andrejic. He had a transmission / mechanic shop in East Chicago, Indiana, Lakeside Transmissions.
Okay.
Lakeside Transmixer shop.
Transmixer, yeah, Transmixer. So okay. My dad is there one day getting his car repaired. Right. Okay. This is, I want to say like May of 69.
All right.
And Serbo tells him, hey, my son's got this Serbian band started, the accordion player. And he got the two accordions, guitar. They're looking for a drummer. My tata says, hey, my son plays the drums, man. No problem. He'd love to do this. You know, let's get him over there. And Serbo's all excited. He goes, oh, this is great, man. You know, so my dad comes home and tells me, hey, Sine, I got a new band for you to play in. I go, what's up, Dad? He goes, you're going to play Serbian music. I go, what? What are you talking about? I'm like, so I'm 15 years old. Okay. I'm, you know, Motown. I'm doing, you know, all hard rock stuff, Jimi Hendrix, you know, Grand Funk Railroad. That's what I was into because that's what I wanted to do. Like, influence from my older brother who also played guitar. So I was like, I don't want to play no Serbian stuff. What's the matter with you, man? No, come on. It's going to be fun. Don't worry. So I had no choice. You know, we're not driving or anything. He says, come on, we're going to practice the next day. Throws the drums in a car. We drive over to Serbo's house, or Tommy's, you know, Tommy's house. And we go down to the basement, start carrying my drums down there. First thing I see, there's all these folding chairs in the basement there. And all the parents are sitting there from the other three kids. You know, they're all sitting like in a semicircle. I'm like, uh-oh. And I had the long hair and the whole thing, so I was already like labeled, oh, this isn't going to be good, man. This kid looks like trouble, you know. He's doing drugs and everything. Don't worry. So, you know, anyway, I get down there and I was like, you know, met everybody. And I said, I don't know what you guys are expecting. This is all new to me. Let's try it out and see. And tried a couple simple calls and a couple other things. And I was doing some really different, more upbeat stuff, more on the kind of like a rock side, if you will. It wasn't your standard stuff that you would normally hear.
Right.
And Tommy, the whole time, is just looking at me, smiling big. He's, oh yeah, this is what we're looking for. This is going to work. And we just kind of clicked and we had a few more practices, and just before you knew it, it just kind of took off from there as far as solidifying what we were looking for, you know, initially. Right.
So we have a couple of pictures joining us here. Right. We saw your business card in the opening here.
Yep.
Right. Tell me, is this that first group right there?
That's the first group that was taken in my basement in East Chicago. That was, I want to say, probably 1970. Yeah, I want to say that's probably about right, 1970.
All right, so 1970, you guys practice. Your band has come together. This is it. This is what you're doing. You're now in a new genre, right? You went from American rock and whatnot.
Yeah.
To, you know, what we consider today classic rock, right?
Yeah, buddy.
To Serbian. And now, what happens? How do you get your, were they already playing, you said? Yeah.
Well, here's what happened. So they were, you know, they were trying to do a couple of different things. And then Serbo, Tommy's dad, he would call the church, whatever, if anybody was playing like locally, especially at St. Sava was our really foundation. It was for St. Sava. That's, they started our career. They gave us all the exposure. We had all the initial stuff, St. Sava Church in Hobart at the time, obviously, or Gary, well, you know, back on 49th. So sure. He would tell who's ever playing at any of the gigs, whether it was a picnic or a dance or a program, hey, when you guys take a break, would it be okay if the kids come and play, you know? So that's kind of what happened. And back then, Momo Rankovic was like the band, you know, circulating at that time. He was very popular. And we played at a gig at St. Sava. This was probably June. And all the kids were just coming out of nowhere and saying, oh my God, who are you guys?
Yep, just yep. June, summer of 69.
Correct.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And we started playing, and kids were just going crazy. It was like an instant thing. Like, oh, this is great. Oh, you guys are good. And they're running up to my, you know, soon to be my mother-in-law later on, obviously, Amanda, Sonia, and Tommy's mom, and saying, hey, what's the name? What are these kids? Who are these kids? You know, young Serb. They look at all these young Serbian kids. You know, she's just yelling, oh, yeah, young Serbs. Mlada Srbadija. She was saying, oh, these are young Serbs. So it was, I did confirm it was Amanda, my mother-in-law, who came up with the name for the band, Mlada Srbadija. That's, it just took off from there. People were running up asking, who are these kids? Who are these kids? And the name came out of it like that during one of the gigs. So we did that a few times. And before you know it, We played at a couple of picnics and a couple more gigs at St. Sava like that during these breaks. And we started getting the phone calls at Amanda's house, you know, Tommy's house there. She was our booking manager. In fact, I have this whole Tupperware thing here full of all our jobs from start to finish. Like here's, I'm holding up. Here's 1977, for example. You can't believe the stuff that's in here. But anyway,
I can't.
We get a call from I can't remember. I talked to Tommy earlier today. By the way, my brother-in-law can't be on the call tonight. He's in California, and he's attending a company business dinner thing. He just couldn't get out of it, so he apologizes. So we get this phone call from somebody from Libertyville, the camp, summer camp. They're like, we want to book the kids. We want to book Mlada Srbadija for Youth Day to kick off the camp. And, you know, can the kids do it? Absolutely. So that was our first formal gig. Now, you have to understand something, though. I mean, our parents, all the parents took this so serious above us. They were so proud and so enthused. There was so much passion there. Like, you know, like we were like all their sons, you know, too, on top of just being our moms and dads. You know what I mean? We were like all one big happy family. Sure. And Mlada comes up with the ideas. Hey, we got to have matching outfits. You know, we got to get matching. Back then, that was big, Spaz. I mean, we had probably five or six different matching outfits. The whole band matched. Besides in that picture you showed earlier, those vests were made by my mother-in-law. She handmade those. And on the back, there were sequins. They said Mlada Srbadija on the back. So you can't see them, but that was on the back. So
let me pull it out. I think I got a couple pictures. Let's see the back first here. There's the back.
Yeah, but these are our outfits. So here it is now. This is the Youth Day. This is our first gig. Now check it out. It's probably 90 degrees outside. We're wearing white pants, black long sleeve shirts, and white ties. I mean, come on. Are you serious, man? We were just dying, but what a good time we had. You could see all the kids dancing out there in the background there. You know, just having a great time.
Well, this, just confirmed, this is summer of 69, right?
Correct. August of 69. Yep.
Right there. That's the back view right there that we have of you guys. But don't worry, we have a better picture, guys. Vidi. Oh, Vidi.
Hey, there you go. Check it out, man.
There you go. So, tell me who's who here. Who's on the furthest left, the accordion with the keyboard accordion here?
That's Tommy Andreich. That's my brother-in-law. Yep. Okay.
The accordion player in the middle with the Dugmetra?
That's Lubisha Tanaskovic. Yep. Uh-huh.
And the guitar player, as you mentioned earlier, is?
Yeah, Ned Pokrajec on the guitar.
And the guy back there with a lot of hair? A
lot of hair, brother.
That was you?
That's me, man.
Yeah. Right there, folks. So this is summer of 69. This was what you would call or say was your breakthrough gig?
Correct. Okay. And when everybody knew, too, the word got out real fast when that summer camp thing, besides signing up, you know, that's your first day of camp. They have like a big picnic, and you know that was a typical thing back then. The place was jammed. I mean, there was kids, like just mobs of kids just all over the place. It was a great time. It was a good time, man. But check it out too, Spaz. We only probably knew back then, I want to be honest with you, we probably maybe knew maybe 15, 16 songs total, you know what I mean, back then. But it was just the power and the impact of what we drove with the Colos. And the simple things like, you know, the cha-chak and the Nishka Banya was standard. Bitola was standard back there, you know. It was not uncommon to play a song for, you know, 10 minutes, 12 right. minutes. I mean, yeah, and it was, kids were like, if you play it too short, they were like booing at you. So it just developed into that, you know. So.
The pavilion wasn't already built at St. Sava at that time. Is that correct? The pavilion?
No, that wasn't built then.
No, that was the hall. That was the big banquet hall.
Okay.
Yeah.
No. So I just remember there's a redone pavilion at St. Sava, Libertyville, that they redid.
Oh, you're talking about Libertyville. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Libertyville. But that was where that was, right?
Yes, that's Libertyville. Correct.
But did they just put you on like
it was like this wooden platform. I don't know, some
2x2.
Makeshift with the stage, man, or whatever. Somebody put it up. And the kids are dancing like in sand and dirt. There was stuff just being spit up. You could tell everybody was just getting all dirty and stuff because it was all dusty and dirty and kids were dancing hard and barefoot and stuff. Yeah, it was pretty cool, man.
Did you ever have power problems up there when you played, like struya issues?
Oh, boy. No, I don't think so. I mean,
it comes to mind immediately, right? I mean,
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. To be honest, I don't remember. And I honestly don't think so, you know, so.
Bravo. Okay, so summer of 69 comes through. You guys put it into gear. You're starting to play. What happens next? Where do you see most of the calls coming through? You said St. Sava became like the base?
Yeah, St. Sava was like the base. So it was kind of like an automatic, I guess, kind of like your house, like you're a house band, if you will. You know, they kind of like grabbed us right away, not like, you know, unwritten contract. Okay, we got the programs. We got the Zabavas. We got the Folklore Fest. We got New Year's Eve. We got St. Sava Day. You know, St. Sava was like trying to grab us for everything they could. Harbor, East Chicago grabbed us a lot too. We played in the Harbor a lot, you know.
And were you all like 15 at the time?
16? Yeah, I was 15. So Tommy and Ned, I think, were 14. And Lubo was maybe, I think he's a year older than me. So he might have been maybe 16. Or,
you know, so you're all in that age range, right?
Yeah. That little, 14, 15, 16 range, you know.
Miguel, let me ask you a question. How did you start playing drums? You know, were you, how did that whole?
I picked it up earlier when I was a lot younger. It just kind of came. I never took a lesson in my life, I'll be honest with you. I was self-taught along with my brother. He played guitar. Mm-hmm. I learned how to read music, obviously, in school. But I started playing in fifth grade. It was we were doing a school play, and they needed, looking for some background, like for some drums, something real simple. Mm-hmm. And they asked me if I could do it because I was already, practicing at home. So my brother already had a band, so the equipment was left at my house. So I would just, when they weren't there, I would just kind of go on the drums and kind of self-taught myself. It was just, it just came easy. It was natural. So,
well, does your dad play the accordion?
Yeah. My dad played the accordion. He also played the drums. Not much. He wasn't that much of a drummer per se, but he did enough just to, make dangerous to get by to play along with accompany Momorankovich a few times here and there whenever they needed some fills, but his original, instrument was the accordion.
Wow. And if we go a step further, your grandfather was what?
Yeah, my father, on my father's side, my grandfather was a professor of music in Yugoslavia. That's correct.
Crazy, huh? Look at that. Three generations in, you guys are still, and you're still playing today.
Still playing, brother.
On top of that.
Over 50 years now, man.
So growing up, did you listen to English music only? Or did you listen to Serbian English? How did that work?
No Serbian music. It was, the influence, because remember, I went to East Chicago, Washington, so I grew up with the whole thing of Motown. But fortunately for my brother, a lot of influence because he played guitar and he was really into rock and roll. He's older, so he brought the influence of, back then, this is the late 60s, early 70s. So you had the Woodstock was the big thing and all the big bands like The Who, Grand Funk Railroad, Jimi Hendrix, all these bands like that were big back then. And but I loved Motown too because I grew up with it in Washington. That's all we had. All the dances were all consisted of, Motown type music. So I was really into it because I liked playing all the funky stuff, man. I loved it.
So you do the summer of 69, you get the break, you start playing. Are you, and you're filling up fast from what I understand, right?
Filling up fast. It was right after youth day. It was just nonstop. Okay, here comes Labor Day. Oh, yep, got it. Labor Day picnic. Here, it was just one thing after all of a sudden, here comes, you have to remember something too, Spaz, back then, and people that are listening to the baby boomers, you could attest to it that Zabavas were like the thing back then. Zabavas were huge. Almost every Saturday night, there was a Zabava going somewhere, South Chicago on 114th or in the Harbor. Or in St. Sava, somebody was always hosting some big dance, it could have been too from some, whether it was from a church organization or even some of the folks that had the radio shows back then, Mr. Bolotovich, and then you had, Velinka, Isalovich, all these people were hosting all these things, and that was big, man. So it was Folklore Fest were huge back then, and it was not uncommon, even after the program. Check this out. So you had the tables and chairs set up, like in as big as the halls were. Mm-hmm. It still wasn't enough room for the colas. I mean, I'm not kidding. I'm not trying to brag or anything. I'm just telling you, when the kids danced the colo back then, they had to move all the tables out of the way. So it was just chairs, if you will, like in a big circle around the hall against the wall, because sure, they needed all the floor to dance. Colo dancing, colo was 200, 300, 400. Wasn't uncommon to see a colo like that. It was just like normal. That's what we grew up with, man.
And that's great because you picked up. So would you say that you probably took away gigs or wound up sharing the slice of the pie with Momorankovich, who was on the scene at that time? Is that what happened?
I don't know, I want to be, not disrespectful or taking away gigs. I think it was just because of the generation that came along and was tagging onto this whole new thing of these young kids playing on stage. It was just like a whole new thing. We were like the first band to take it to the next level. Besides the band that was before us, but we took it to that. again, you always saw, you heard the term already from a few people. It's that power cola. We drove it, and how we just rose it up to that level to make it just a little bit different. And it's just, I think the energy and the passion of the people that grew up in that era, man, I wouldn't have traded it for the world. You know, it was just something different, man. And it just high energy. Everything was just high. Even the slower songs, you know, it was high energy, man. So
the band is moving on, and now it transitions. Something happens to the band. What is the first big change in the band in those years? It goes from 4 to 3 members now, because Mr. Tanashkovich leaves the band. It goes elsewhere.
Yeah.
And then there's a nucleus of 3. Is that correct?
Correct. Yeah, we just continued on. Lubisha wanted to go in a different direction, so we parted our ways. It was okay. We just kept the energy going, and it was good. We kept it 3, and the gigs just kept coming, so it was fine. We didn't miss a beat, you know.
So now summer of 73 is rolling around. Mm-hmm. 1973, mind you.
Yes, sir.
And Vinko Mancic says, "Ja moram da idem u školu."
Yeah.
I want an education. And Vinko Mancic, ladies and gentlemen, says, I want to go to ASU.
Yep. I went to my freshman year of college. I went to Indiana University Northwest in Gary. So I was still keeping, you know, playing with the band. I was actually working midnights at the steel mills with my father. He worked in the daytime. I worked at midnights. Right. And
Was that common back then? I see a lot of families.
Yeah. That was pretty common, man. You went to the army or something like that back in those days, you know, or you ended up working at the steel mills. And that was kind of like a normal thing. If you wanted to go to a local college, if you didn't go down to campus. So I did, because I wanted to continue playing with Srbadija. We didn't want to give that up. I went, you know, right there in Gary. And went to college full time in the day, worked midnights, and played in the band on weekends. So, but then by the next year, that was in 72, because I graduated in 72 from high school.
Okay.
So did that 1 year, and then I had an opportunity to go to ASU to continue on, and decided that's what I wanted to do.
So Vinko goes to ASU in the summer of 93, and now tell me what happens with Mlada Srbadija. They have, this is becoming a very... Yeah. Very eerily similar to the United Service, where they're changing drummers now, right?
Yeah. So this is very cool. I want to throw in too. So Spaz, you got to remember something during this time. You got to remember, so even like what we were doing with the Serbian dances, this was going on with the generation of like all the Greeks. There was a very popular band back then too. They had the same kind of charisma, same kind of energy. They were doing the same thing with all the Greek kids. They were, you know, getting exposed to the same energy. They were called Linda and Her Stars. It was a family. They were really good band. There was the Sirikas brothers. Remember those guys, Nick? And then there was the Macedonian band. They same thing. They were called the Young Macedonians. And in fact, two of the guys that were in that band actually stood up in my wedding. Tom Metlovsky and Perry Spirich played in that band. So they had that popularity thing going too. So this was all going on during this time, man. So, you know.
So you go to ASU. Who replaces you?
So, yep. This kid, Norman Curtis was his name. His brother played keyboards. I think, I don't know if he played accordion. I know he played keyboards. But this kid was like the real deal. This guy was, wow, he was a really super, super good drummer, man. He fit right in. Tommy knew about him. This and that came right up. He says, hey, you want to play? Vinko's leaving. It was like a smooth transition, man. Because he was already, you know, he knew it from the Macedonian side. So it was pretty easy for him just to transition over. So it was a perfect fit for them, you know.
Okay, so now you leave, and the Macedonian guy comes on in. He replaces you as a drummer, and they're still booked. They're booked south,
yep.
Right?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
A year, maybe even two, as we spoke earlier.
Yep, yep.
In advance. Where does Mr. Tarilo come into the picture? I think this is where that transition comes in.
Well, here's what happens before I introduce Nick here. So
tell me.
Tragedy sets in with the band Mlada Srbadija. Mm-hmm. The summer of 75, Norman graduates from high school. Okay. And they're having a party at the I don't know if it's Miller Beach or right over there by the dunes over there, okay, in Gary. And Norman went out to the water and never came back. He drowned. So it was a real bad thing. He died right after high school, right after graduation.
Wow.
Which was bad. And then my brother-in-law, well, soon to be brother-in-law, called me and said, "Hey, is there any way you would consider coming back right now?" And I was, you know, again, in the middle of trying to finish school, and I was playing with a big time band out there. I just wasn't ready. You know, so I said, I'm sorry, Tommy, I just can't do it right now. please forgive me. And, you know, just hopefully something will happen. And then that's when they got the replacement, Damon, correct, Nick?
That not yet.
Yeah, before you came in.
He got me in. Tommy got me in, and he wanted a drummer. We had Rich Pascash. Rich Pascash came in and played. He was a rock and roller that had played with me in a rock and roll band. He was Serbian and Romanian, so he knew the music. Mm-hmm. And he played a couple of gigs, but he was very reserved, you know, very, you know, too conservative. And then Linda's youngest brother.
Yes.
Linda's youngest brother from the Greek band comes in, and we had him, and he was good. So he, you know, not saying Rich wasn't good. Rich was good in his own way, but this little kid, mm-hmm. and I'm talking about a little kid. He was like 12 years old, 13 years old.
He's a very, very short term, though. Very short term.
Very short term. He's playing with us. And then we had Damon Tsouklas that came in. He was a little bit older, and he was playing. And then Vinko comes back. And I look, I said, who the hell is this guy? And Tommy goes, that's a new drummer. I said, who? That's Vinko. He was the original one. I didn't know Vinko, mm-hmm. but I knew his dad, Jole, because I was hanging around in the harbor at the time with a very good friend of mine. And, you know, Vinko and I kind of hit it off right off the bat.
Oh, right off the bat.
And the first night we're playing the gig, I think we're playing a picnic.
You're playing. Well, let me come back just to 1 second. This is kind of an important piece. So it was an unwritten rule with the band. You know, they knew that if Vinko ever came back home, he's automatically back in the band. It was just kind of like everybody knew that. All the drummer, whoever the thing was, it was just like a polite, cordial, whatever, you know, unwritten thing of, hey, Vinko,
know this. Yeah.
There's no, I'm not trying to take your gig. I'm not trying to step on your toes. It was just an automatic thing. And I felt kind of bad when I first came back. I said, are you sure this is okay? This and that, da, da, da. But no, everybody already knows, blah, blah, blah. I'm going to fade the kid out, this and that. So you guys are playing at a picnic at Sveti Ilija's.
Yeah.
And I come walk back
what
there.
Year is this? What year is this?
This is summer of 76.
Summer of 76. Okay.
Yeah, because we need to back up a little bit. So
could have been 75.
No, 76.
Okay. All right.
Because it's after Serbo died. I came back that summer. So Tommy's and my wife, you know, Serbo, Chica, my father, he passed away in May of 76. Sonia graduated from high school. I came back. I flew back for the funeral because I was in Arizona. I came back for the funeral, talking to everybody. I really missed home, this and that. I said, I don't know. This is going to be kind of tough. So I went back, gave my notice with everything, trying to finish up all my stuff over there. And then I moved back home, you know, like about a month later.
So you come in and Mr. Trial was already in the band. So
correct.
There. So
him and I hit it off. Yeah.
Nick, tell me a little bit about yourself. When did you start playing and what instrument did you come in playing with the band?
I came in playing bass guitar with the band. That's what I played in the rock and roll band from the time I was in high school on.
English. English rock and roll. Just to make
English rock and
roll.
Yeah,
buddy.
American music.
Yes.
before that, I played a Serbian cello and a Bugatti. The only reason I played a Bugatti is because my sister had one and put it down and I took it. But the bass guitar with Tommy, it was the first time he ever had a bass, but he needed something to fill it in. And it was fun. It was fitting good. It was a nice beat. People, you know, I had people tell me, we feel like you're pounding us in the chest when you're playing, which was a good idea. Of course, there's another story we've got, but that one, Vinko will tell you later. But the thing was, Vinko and I should get up there and we start playing this and the people are dancing. And he'd hit that bass, the bass drum, the same time I'd hit a low note. And we learned how to syncopate that. And Ned comes in, ring, ring. And it just clicked. It was just something. You're throwing all this power and sound out. And all the people are throwing it back at you.
Sure.
It was unbelievable.
It's the energy you're working off of each other, right?
Right.
Yeah, Spaz, you have to understand something. I'd like to just interject here for a second, and I really want to emphasize this because what's Srbadija abroad, and I just can't figure out even till today when I, you know, and with all the other music going on, is the level we took the Serbian music to with this, you know, I keep the term power kolo. It was just something different. It was unique. It was very hard driven. It was almost like a rock, very much rock influence to make that. The power of how these songs sounded, all the songs and how, you know, the intricate parts and how tight we were. I mean, it was just incredible the way
it
we
was
just
thing,
killed
though,
it
too. It, when you're taught Serbian music, it's like you've got the professor hanging over you. exactly like this. You missed that note. Yeah. You'd miss, you know, and we got to the point what felt good, we played it. And sometimes we'd throw something in that would never have been played before. And it was just, you know, it sounded good, we used it. If yeah, it didn't buddy. Sound good, we didn't use it. But I mean, there were times we dropped all the music instruments completely and just stood up there and pretended like we were making our noises. Boom, 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 boom. You know,
well, that came out a little bit later with the voices, acapella, you know, for, yeah, we'll talk but about just that.
Goofy stuff, and people went crazy. We had fun with it.
Yeah, yeah.
Just, you know, Nick, there's some fame to Mr. Nick Turiello here too. And if you don't know, ladies and gentlemen, Nick Turiello is the son of Pokojni Branko Turiello of Branko Chicken Delight. And
originally, yeah.
Originally. And what I know growing up is Branko's Pizza.
Yeah.
That's what I grew up to. I'm familiar with Branko's Pizza. How did can you tell us a little bit how your dad got into that whole deal? And was he a musician at all, or was he just a business man?
My dad, one of the jokes in the family was when they moved back to, when they came back to the States and lived in Detroit before I was born, the choir in Detroit asked my dad not to sing. Because my mom was from Windsor, but they were living in Detroit. So my dad was asked not to sing. He didn't really have an ear for music. He uh-huh. loved music. He loved to hear it. He loved us when we played because we played loud. And that's one thing that he was having a little bit of hard of hearing type of things. But
sure.
Yeah. He retired in 64. He started working for the government in December 8th, 1941. And he was with the Federal Housing Authority when he got out in 64, wanted to find something to do. He got into the little restaurant. He always wanted to deal with food.
And you continued that tradition by, holding the restaurants. Is that correct?
Right. I mean, I had my stints in the steel mill, and I worked for a racing car company for a while. It was fun. It was different things, but somehow I always went back to the restaurant.
But you always played throughout this whole time, did you not, Nick?
I did. As much as I could, I played with these guys, Mlada Srbadija. And then later I'd teamed up with the Medic brothers from South Bend. Mm-hmm. And we played, we had a very good tambura group. It was Wayne Sajlovic, myself, Stevie Medic, and Milan Medic.
So I just want you to know, Nick, my love for tambura, first of all, I'm from Vojvodina. And my Baba and Dad listened to a little bit of tambura growing up. I wasn't a big fan of it growing up. And then something happened in 1996. There was live tambura music every Tuesday night at Branko's Pizza in Crown Point.
Oh, yeah.
Tuesday night, live music. And me and my friend Slajana Pejnović at the time. And we wound up coming. I think I spent 6 months every Tuesday night. And I fell in love with tambura music. And it was at Branko's Pizza that all happened, and that transpired. So, but I did hear that you played before. I did hear that you played after. Now that means you played tambura, you played Serbian boom boom band, and you played American rock, right?
Right.
A little bit of everything. So, mm-hmm. Growing up, did you listen to just English music, or were you listening to more Serbian music too?
You know, I listened to everything. My dad had a great record collection, and I still have a lot of 78s and stuff, the old ones. Mm-hmm. But I think we'd gone to Europe in 62 because my father wanted to see where his parents had come from, and we came back. My dad had bought every album he could buy, all the Yugoton, you know, things, and sure. Play them every night at home on the big stereo, you know, the one that took up half the room, you know, half the living room.
Sure.
You hear this stuff, you get used to it, and you like it, and you play it, you mimic it. And it was just something that I still do. You go to my car right now, you open it up, you could put Seals and Croft or Hall & Oates in, or the Beatles in, or you could grab any number of songs from, Tozovac or Trio Goose, you know, any of those.
So would it be correct to say that you guys were the first quote unquote boom boom band?
Absolutely. At the next level, there was a band prior to us,
okay.
But Shumadia. not full. They didn't use the drummer the way we use the drummer, if you will, for every song. But there was a band prior to us that I would say were the original, not 100% boom boom, but in that pattern. So we, you know,
they didn't
kind of looked up to them.
Use the drum and the bass. We syncopated everything.
Yeah,
and it was just, you know, it was, you felt it, not only heard it.
Yep.
Well, it's a new sound, right? That was.
It was the new sound, correct? And we remember the generation. So that generation, you grew up in that, you know, from that era, from the 69 to like that 75, 77 era, those that age group, because Shumadia was a little bit older than us too. So they had the generation before us, you know what I mean?
And they were in Milwaukee. Yeah.
They were in Milwaukee, correct.
It was the Milwaukee-based band that we're talking about, right?
Correct.
Yeah. Guys, I'm going to throw a few pictures up on the screen. Tell me a little bit about each picture.
I was hoping, because I want you to go back to one. I want to talk about one.
I mean, when was this? Is this part of that? What year is this, and what do you see this as?
Oh, boy, where was this at? This is...
There's youth on the wall back there.
This looks like... let me see the floor there. Looks like
South Chicago.
That's South Chicago. Yeah. Looks like South Chicago.
San Simeon.
So just a probably a big Zabava in South Chicago. Looks like. Yep.
Tell me about this picture, guys.
Oh yeah. Who's that, Nick?
My wedding.
What is this?
That was my wedding.
Tell me something about it, will you?
Well, I got three jabbers there with me.
What happened to my hair, man? What's up with that?
let's name all these people. Who's the guy with the fro?
That's Ned Pokrajec, man. Yeah.
Ned Pokrajec.
Yeah.
And there's Tommy.
Tommy, the accordion player. And then.
And Vinkel. Yeah. And then me.
Nick with the famous mustache. He had that mustache for, seems like forever, man.
Still do.
Yeah.
Can't see it. It's
there it is.
Yeah.
All right. So that was that picture. And then tell me about that. Where is this picture from?
The same place. Isn't it?
No, wait a minute. We got our tuxedos on. Wait a minute.
Oh,
that's your wedding.
That's my wedding. Yeah, we played at my wedding too.
Yeah, that's your wedding, Nick.
All right, and then we move on to this.
This is Cherville Church. This is the old hall in Cherville.
Okay.
This is the original hall. Yeah, in Cherville. We played a lot of gigs there too. A lot of gigs, man.
The one they have in the back there still, correct?
Correct. Yeah, the old property. Yes. Ooh, behind the church.
Was that the New Year's Eve party?
If it's our tuxedos, that's New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
Spaz, yeah.
I don't know. Can't tell from too far from here.
There. Yep, that is. Yep. So this is 1977, New Year's Eve.
1977.
Correct.
And then we got some other pictures here on the side. What's that from, you know?
Now, check this out. This was from our famous beer blast. Our beer blast at Svetilia. You don't understand, man, about this gig. So this is on a stage at Svetilia. You can see the heavy, big organ that Tommy had over there with the keyboards, you know. So this is where we were doing the heavy rock and roll stuff. Remember, we were playing rock and roll too. We introduced that with the Serbian music.
So we introduced ourselves that night as the Whiz Kids.
Yes, the Whiz Kids.
And we played rock and Serbian stuff. And it was the 25th of December, Christmas night.
Christmas Day night.
American Christmas.
Spaz, the place was so full of people, you couldn't. First of all, when we told them we were going to do this gig, the person that was managing all said, "Oh, you don't need to have the whole hall. You're not going to get enough people. Just have it in that front hall. You know that front hall when you walk in." And saying, "This is all the space you need." We're going, "Dude, no, you don't understand, man. All the American people are going to come. Everybody's home from college. Sure. All the Serbians. We're going to play American and Serbian music. It's a beer blast,
the
man.
Greeks,
you know, 25 cents a beer, man. You know, $5 to get in. I mean, it was just insane. It was jam."
The
jam
Greeks
packed.
Came out.
Yeah.
The Macedonians came out.
Yeah, yeah.
The Croatians came out. The place was packed with people.
Packed.
And you know what? It was about a month later, the church board goes, "We're going to have a beer blast every year."
Yeah, so people try to copy it after that. It wasn't, I don't think there was one that successful. But, man, I tell you what, we just decided to do it. Mlada Srbadija said, "Hey, let's rent the hall on our own. Let's take a chance." We had a pretty good following along with American and Serbian. And like Nick said, too, when the Greek kids and the Macedonian kids, there wasn't anything going on. They would, whatever Srbadija was playing, they came out to check us out, man. You know,
when did you guys introduce the English music to your repertoire? Because it wasn't always like that, right?
No.
Okay. When did that happen? When did that transition happen?
It came kind of like in stages prior to Nick, because my brother, I mentioned earlier, he played guitar.
Right.
he came over to a few practices and was like jamming with us. So we'd go down in the basement there and jam, and we were trying to some American stuff out. So that was early on too.
Some select gigs, right? He not
full correct. Time, right? Yeah. He wasn't like a full time. If we had some certain gigs, maybe a wedding or we knew there was going to be like a lot of kids there type of a gig. And we would end our set with this. We play a full set of Serbian at the end of each set. We play like three or four American songs.
So what year do you think that came in?
Yeah, this is like 71, 72.
That early you started playing English music.
I'm sorry. Wait, let me think. I'm sorry. 72 for sure.
Okay. So 72.
Yep.
So since you brought up 72, let me go back to 72. Something that everybody asks for. Everybody's always asking. Who created chicken? Who created chicken? How did chicken wind up being called chicken? And a lot of times people say vinco. Well, so tell me a little bit about that famous chicken.
First of all, we're going to clear the air right now with when you say who invented chicken. It's who invented chicken the way Mlada Srbadija played it, not so much the original music where the kolo came from, because that Srbadija used to play that in the Milwaukee band we mentioned.
Okay.
But they didn't play it with certain parts. It was just a little bit different. And it definitely, again, with the drums, that was totally missing. So the drum stuff, that all came later, goofing around at a practice with the shaft beginning and all that kind of stuff. It actually, we were just goofing around at practice. They were trying different things. And I started playing it. And next thing you know, we're coming in with the intro. And 1, 2, 3, 4, let's go.
For those of us who don't know what shaft is, can you elaborate a little bit?
Oh, yeah, the shaft. Remember, there was a movie back in the 70s.
I don't remember, sir.
There was a movie called Shaft, and the theme from that movie was the theme from Shaft. And it started with with the actual hi-hat. That was part of the song. That was, if you listen to the song now by Isaac Hayes, it comes in with the theme from Shaft. That's where I got that from, because, again, being growing up with Motown, sure, I was always playing that kind of stuff between James Brown and all that. That was just part of the thing. And it just kind of goofing around, and we did a couple of this, couple of that, and 1, 2, 3, 4. And next thing you know, it was Tommy would come in, did it, a little bit, kind of teasing. And here it just kind of grew from there. And again, we kind of did this before. Nick really took it up to another level later on when Nick joined the band. But with all that stuff, the voices and all that came in. We did that earlier before Nick too. But when Nick came in, and I'll let Nick tell it too, I don't want to hog the whole thing, where we were adding all these other different kind of sounds. Everybody, all four of us were doing it. And we even got to a point where, so remember, the kolo was very long anyway. It was rocking. When you play chicken, it was like, oh my God, forget about it, right? So there'd be a part, we'd all do a cappella. Mm-hmm. And Nick kind of, that was like another thing. It was just kind of a joke. We just started doing it. So Nick would dum 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 with the bass, and I'd go chicka 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 with my mouth, and Ned with the guitar ching 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 ching, and Tommy just playing with his mouth, accordion notes. We did that for like 5 minutes before we go back into the song. It's just, and people just in the audience were doing it too. So it was
cool. Then we would leave Vinko up there playing the drums.
Yeah.
And Tommy and I and Ned would go sit down.
Or they would go dance. They'd run out to go dance a cola and take turns.
The cola's still going on.
I'd still be doing the drum stuff.
Started coming up on stage and dancing across the stage.
Yep.
And then we'd go back one by one and start playing our instruments again. And
so, the dance step that they do for chicken, did that happen when Srbadija started playing it? Or did that kind of grow with when you guys started that new sound?
So yeah, exactly. When we started the new sound, and people, if you looked from the stage and you looked down, because you were kind of bouncing up and down a lot because of the speed that we played. You remember, we never did anything slow, except for the slow songs, but chicken was killer. Serbian aerobics at its best. So you kind of bounce and you kind of look like a chicken. You see a chicken kind of going up and down. So even the nickname with the chicken thing got even more exposed or more popular because of that,
And so what year did you start doing that? What 72, 73?
That was like 72, 73. Yep.
That's what I thought it was. So that's why I brought it up, since you brought up 72. I didn't want to forget that, because that's a very, very, the last two interviews with Mlados and Danny Danilovich from the United Serbs, everybody's asking chicken. And one name that's continuously brought up with that is Vinko Mancic.
So again, I, with all due respect to everybody, with all the musicians, I can take credit for that part with the shafting, making that what it is. That's absolutely, that's on us, and taking it to that level with all of what we did with it. But again, the music, we can't take the music thing came from another Colo. Sure. And then Tommy added a bunch of parts too. So there was some more parts added to the Colo as we progressed, making chicken what it is still today.
Also, yeah. The only professional or the first professional.
That's correct.
Which was Kumovi.
And that's where it starts, right?
Yes. Yep. Yes. So that was, I was glad we did that. It's my biggest regret. I got to tell you right now, Spaz, I just telling my wife the other day when, you know, after we decided we were going to do this, I was so excited that our biggest regret, and even my brother-in-law, was, you know, we didn't make any recordings. We should have made a recording, a professional recording, a record or anything back then. I regret not doing that. We, you know, it was hard to even come up with just in general recordings even today. I know some people have some. You got to remember, every time we played somewhere, Spaz, too, I mean, people would just put a boombox back in the day. They put it on a stage, hit the record button, and just walk away. In fact, sure. The songs that you're listening to tonight was from 1976, a gig we played in St. Louis. Mm-hmm. So that's the one I found. That's where it came from.
We were all working. Yeah. And when we'd finish a job, I might have to go back to the mill that night. Yeah. Tommy worked I don't know, where was Tommy?
He was at the mills too.
Ned would drive down to Lafayette. He was in school.
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, you'd party hardy, and then one guy would drive 2 hours and the rest would work.
So nobody had this as their primary source of income.
That's correct.
Yeah.
It's always a great side gig, right?
Oh boy.
Correct. Yep. Well, we were teenagers, so that's, I mean, I would it be all right if you just backed up for a minute, Spaz, on the, if you go back to our pictures, because you show that one with the truck. The pickup truck with the Mlada Srbadija sign.
And it's right there.
Okay, so now this, I have to bring this up because I got to tell you something. You know, we're missing a boat. If I don't say this, I'll never forgive myself. Srbo Andrej, that's him standing right there between me and Ned. I mean, that's me in the shorts there with my elbows crossed. So that's Srbo. That's Tommy's dad, my wife's dad. Check out the sign, Mlada Srbadija. That's his truck. Now, you remember, we were kids. We didn't even have license or permits. Our parents had to drive us around to the gigs. We're 14, 15 years old, right? This is the golf tournament in Indianapolis, Chica Srbo. God bless him. My father-in-law was the best. He was so passionate. He loved us so much. This meant the world to him. When his son was playing accordion, I mean, this guy, we walked out. We couldn't do no wrong. We walked on water. He did everything for us. And this guy, remember, he had his own business, and he worked really hard, and he always made time for us. Oh, I got to take my kids. I got to drive them to Indianapolis. I got to drive them to South Chicago. Sonia's mom, my mother-in-law, made those posters, and we taped those on the side of the pickup truck with Mlada Srbadija. That was like our thing, and people were just like, it was just so cool. So this is the golf tournament down in Indianapolis, Indiana. I just wanted to point that out. So this is like probably, wow, I don't know.
What year is this?
Probably 1970, maybe. Yeah, maybe, because Lubo was still in the band. So, yeah, I want to say 1970.
So there we go. Mlada Srbadija on their way to Indianapolis for a golf tournament.
Yep.
And I got a couple more pictures I want to show and share with everybody here because we have a nice collection of pictures this time around. And tell me about that one.
Well,
look at that little guy in white right there.
Oh, my God. This is my wedding. So, and that's Ned Pokrajec and Branko Vasic holding me up. They were singing a song. I don't even know what song it was, but yeah, they were on stage holding me up. And there you could see that was Momo Rankovic. Well, that was the other accordion player. Lubo was playing the accordion. Mm-hmm. Remember I mentioned that kid from the Macedonian band, Tom Metloff. You see that guy playing clarinet? That's Tom Metloff.
Okay.
Playing clarinet on this. I don't know what song we were playing, but yeah, that's from my wedding, my reception. So.
And that, you know what? I let me add this too. To be there at that wedding, to see Vinko there on stage, he and I almost didn't make it because we're at his house with the scoop and saying bye to everybody. We had a drink. We're getting ready to leave. It's snowing. And turn around, our ride was nowhere to be found. They left us there, and they're all at the church wondering where I'm coom for the wedding, and I got the groom with me.
We had no right to the church, man.
We had no way to the church.
They're not starting without you, I promise.
Right? Oh my God, it was hilarious, man. Oh.
Yeah. Tell me about this picture. Look at these two guys.
Oh my God, check out the clothes, man. That one. You know, this is the 70s.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, geez. So,
ladies and gentlemen, on the left side, there is Vinko Mandžić, and on the right side, there is Nick Rylo. Once upon a time and now. There you go.
Oh, God. Oh boy.
Yikes.
Yeah. Stara Srbadija.
You can turn it off now, man, for sure.
So, I'm going to throw a couple more pictures up before we're going to play a song so everybody can hear.
Yeah, it'd be great.
Yeah. Tell me about this picture right here. Where was this?
Yeah, this was at a wedding in Lansing, Illinois at Glen Oaks.
Remember Glen Oaks, yeah.
Glen Oaks. This was a wedding. I don't know to remember the actual name of the place. It was Glen Oaks Banquet Center or something like that.
Mm-hmm, okay.
Yeah, so it was a wedding we were
playing. Yeah, I remember that because I stepped into my guitar and broke it that night.
Yeah, what about this right here? What is this?
So, yeah, this was from the same evening. So the photographer came up to us and said, hey, man, I could do like some really, you guys want to take some like cool pictures during your break? We can go outside and I could do some of this like neat stuff like this. So we said, yeah, why not? We don't care. So that's what we did. We went out there and he took some pictures like this.
That's when we had 8 guys in the band.
Yeah.
So there we go. And what year is this approximately?
This is 77.
77. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to go ahead and play a song. Do you know what year these songs were recorded from? What year was the...
It was 76.
Yeah, this is the songs you're playing are from 76, the St. Louis gig. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So I got... what song do you want here? Which one did you want, Nico? Which we played?
I want to do... remember we mentioned everybody's going to love this. Everybody just drop what you're doing, get ready to dance because, like I told you, the power, the intensity, and just listen to the intricacy of just how good everybody was on their instruments and how tight this band really was. And it was like just so easy for us. And we just loved it. The passion coming from both sides. Go into like Chachuk and Malo, and I'll tell you how this all works out, man.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Chachuk and Malo Kolo by Mlada Srbadija. Enjoy it. We'll be back in a few. And now this is recorded with what? How was this recorded?
A boombox. Somebody put a boombox on the stage and hit record, man.
A boombox in front of a speaker.
Yep.
That will explain the quality, ladies and gentlemen. Please.
Amen. I apologize for that. Yeah.
Here we go. There we go. From 1976, right, guys?
That's correct.
Right.
Colo, Mlada Srbadija, 1976. Yo! Thank you. That's that pounding he was talking about. I can hear it, huh? Mlada Srbadija. Yo! A lot of memories, ladies and gentlemen. Mlada Srbadija. All right, Mlada Srbadija, ladies and gentlemen. Look at that. Look at that. Question to Usman, huh? Picture after picture after picture, huh, guys? All right, so that was Chachak and Malakola, and we heard that pounding that you were talking about early, right? That energy, it was full of pounding. Yataku.
Yes. Yeah.
Tell me, who were your musical influences? Vinko? I mean, how did your hand not hurt after 50 years of playing Boże Moje? Damn, it's like,
I mean, if you, start from the beginning, I mean, God, Ginger Baker from the band called Cream, the original Cream. I mean, because I was listening again, I got exposed to that from my brother from all these rock bands. Mm-hmm. The Who, you got the drummer from Jimi Hendrix. Just, on and on and on. I mean, these guys it was just.
Mr. Turillo, yours?
Yeah.
Your musical influences?
Well.
Serbian or.
Oh, Serbian too.
Yeah. I'll tell you, when it comes to the Serbian influence, my first memories of Serbian music were falling asleep on the stage behind the tamburashi when I was a little kid. And I'll never forget when they organized the first tambura group at St. Sava's. Milan Opusic says to me, you do want to play, don't you? And I said, yes, I do. I mean, I really do. He goes, good. I'm going to show you. You're going to play the instrument that I play. I was overjoyed. It was amazing.
That was another legendary name as far as I'm concerned. Oh. Right?
Yep. Yes. Yep. You betcha.
Man, do I regret not having an opportunity. I was much younger. Not having an opportunity to speak to him one-on-one. But continue. I'm sorry, Mr. Trial.
The tambura thing, what's neat about that, it's you learn all the words, you learn everything, you learn where the songs come from, and there's a lot of intricacies in tambura that you don't really have in a dance band, which we did dancing. We did a lot of dance music. The few songs we sang, we put together, I think, quite well.
Mm-hmm.
I still like the old tambura. If it's Bunjevačko, or if it's Stara Srpsko, if it's from where my family comes from in Herzegovina and Crna Gora, if they have two notes, and that's it, but it's
that's so true. All right, so tell me, as far as why not, did you guys ever come out with your own stuff, right? Your own original music?
No, not really. No. We tagged, there was parts, you know, Tommy would add parts, you know, different, his own kind of parts to colos and stuff like that. You know what I mean? On top of during a colo.
The Las Vegas colo. Yeah.
You know, there were some different things.
Okay.
But you got to, you know, back then too, Spez, I want to point out that, remember we said all the energy and how colos were perceived in that time, everybody dancing, but it was all ages. You know, you don't see that like more today. Back in the day, it was not uncommon to see the dance floor with all ages of people dancing. You know, it didn't matter if you were young and old, people just wanted to dance. Right. And during a set, it was very common for us to, we'd break it to Zabavnest, that we play a slow song, we play a polka, you know, we play a cha-cha or a waltz. That was like part of the thing. And then again, always ending up, you know, later on, obviously, we'd end up with the rock and roll stuff, and people just loved it.
And here's another thing too, when it comes to the dance music, the colos, between tambora and what we did, the boom booms, ours was 90% colo uchest, the six-step colo.
Correct.
You know, that you could do six step colos all night long with our kind of band, because that's what most people knew how to dance. You know, I think probably colos like Veliko Colo are probably lost to generations now. But in the old tambora days, you had to play Veliko Colo because, you know, you had the old babas that get out there and they knew these things and they were going to teach the kids. You know, there was differences. It's
go ahead.
Yeah, it's two different worlds, but it's all from one. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
Can you tell me, were you guys given some grief for playing English music at Zabavas? Did people give you grief?
Initially, some places it was.
Yeah, once we had a priest that came and told, Vico and I were standing there talking, and I won't mention the priest's name. He goes,
"Oh, come on, mention the name."
I will not mention.
That's on Nick, man. So yeah,
I will not mention his name, but
we won't mention that.
I'll give you his initials, George Lazich. Anyway, so Father Lazich came to us. He's standing. He goes, "You guys are too loud." Now we're playing loud Serbian music all night long.
Yeah, so
we played two rock and roll songs, and we just finished these two. And he goes, "You're too loud, too loud. You could play." The music is terrible. It's too loud. I said, "Father, what's wrong? Those songs you just played, they're too loud." We didn't play them any louder than we played the Serbian music. He goes, "This man here brought his child, and his child is sick in the ears because your music is too loud." I said, "Really?" He goes, "Yes." I said, "Has he heard our music before?" "He was here last week, and it was too loud." I said, "Then why did he bring the kid back this week?" You know, it's just...
Yeah, why'd you come back, man?
You know, if the music was Serbian and it was loud, it was okay.
Yeah.
But don't play a rock and roll. Father, the one from Harbor, remember?
Yeah, Father Marsetic. Oh, yeah.
He came up on St. Sveti Jovan. On St. Sava Day.
Yep.
And right in the middle, no, stop that. It's a Serbian dance. And so we had to do that. You know, this.
Did you stop in the middle of the? Did you finish the song, or did you stop?
No, we had to stop. We stopped.
Actually, sometimes too, Spaz, to add to that, they would pull the plug. The janitor would pull the plug, unplug us, and we're like, "Are you kidding me?" Yeah, right in the middle of a song, so we started playing it. So we did get a little grief here and there until it finally got so accepted because the kids were screaming, "No, we want it." They realized after a while because we were so dominant, you know, later on in the career of Srbadija, that it was an automatic thing. Everybody knew what you were getting when you hired Srbadija. It was accepted, you know, to have the rock and roll,
and they knew they'd get the crowd. I mean, they knew they'd get the crowd.
Correct.
So well, they knew they would get the crowd that you'd have five different people advertising that we were playing in five different places on the same night. It would get so bad that Manda's phone would be going off the hook. People calling, "Manda, where are the kids playing tonight?"
Yeah.
Because they'd announce we're playing at Southside, we're playing at Kedzie, we're playing in South Bend, we're playing in all these different places.
So
the same night.
Now that you touched on that, let me ask, right? This was a turbulent time for Serbs in the United States and outside of the motherland, right? Because of the split. Right. And tell me, you know, the original sastav of the band, these are all, you would say, Raskolnici, right? EC, Harbor, and St. Sava, right?
Yep.
Members. You know, then all of a sudden, here comes Nick Torello, Mr. Svetilia. joining in. And were you guys affected by the split? Was there drama? Were you able to work everywhere and anywhere? Did you hear, you know, were you not allowed to play because, you know, at a Fed church because most of you guys are rascals or vice versa? Did you guys have issues?
No, we actually broke the barrier, and you know, Nick can speak too. But I remember people like you know, Mr. Grozdanich from, you know, Sherrillville, and Nick's dad was very influential about getting us to play at Sveti Ilija's, when, because everybody, all the parents were at, and the kids would come home, you know, and they go, "Hey, man, Mlada Srbadija, why can't we get them to play at our church? Or why can't, what's going on? We need to have," everybody was talking to their parents, and the parents, when they heard us too, and they saw what was going on, they'd go back to their boards or organizations and say the same thing. Why aren't we hiring Mlada Srbadija? What's the deal here? The kids love the, wherever these guys are, these kids are going. So it was just, it was pretty easy. I mean, it was no pressure, because I know we played a lot, like in Griffith, you know, and you know, for Sherrillville there, and then with Sveti Ilija's, and then all the other churches, you know, across the Midwest there. We were all over the place, man.
You know, so, you know, Mr. Trilo, you told me that you played tambura earlier on, right?
Right.
Did you, any of you dance folklore? Were you part of that whole folklore scene?
Oh, anyway? God, yeah, I danced, yeah.
Yeah?
Did you dance, Nick, folklore?
What? Folklore I didn't group? Dance folklore, no.
Yeah. My two sisters and my brother, we all danced. You know, my dad says we're dancing, and we all danced, you know, so.
So just to confirm, you have two sisters and a brother, is that right?
Vinko? Correct, yep.
And Nick, yourself?
I have a sister. Yeah, she was in folklore.
Got it. Well, someone has to play, someone has to dance.
Well, that's right. No, she was a Bugatti player.
Okay. Family here, right?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, now we are moving into what would you say your peak was? The peak of your Mlada Srbadija?
You know, we talked about that earlier, Spaz. Now, I don't know if this is going to be misleading, but I think we had a couple of peaks. We had a peak with, when it was us three before I left for Arizona. And then we had, when that Norman kid was in there, they had a good peak because they were rocking. And then when Nick came into the band, we had a real big peak again. And it just kind of rose from there, because that was like the final couple of years of us four being so locked in, especially when you added the bass guitar and what Nick and I brought to the rhythm section on stage, how Ned played, you know, with the guitar, how it just worked in and blended so good. It was just great. So I think we had a couple of peaks, if that makes sense. I hope that makes sense. Yeah.
Did you guys ever bump heads about what to play and when to play it while you're playing?
You know what? There are maybe a couple songs somebody didn't want to play once in a while. But it was like we almost knew what we're going to play next just the way the crowd was, how they were feeling. You know, and if somebody once said, "How do you guys do that? You go right from one colo to another," and you know, Ned's on the offbeat, I'm on the downbeat, and all of a sudden it just comes right out. Pretty, and you know, and Vinko's right there holding the thing, boom! It just melts, and it was just a neat thing. We did have one time. There was, in fact, a trivia thing. Boom, boom. Ow. Hey, no, ouch. What's that sound?
What's that noise?
What's that noise? There was one little fisticuffs behind the stage, but we won't mention any names there. And it all turned out very nicely. We finished the job playing as friends.
Tell me, what you guys have a favorite song that you love playing? Serbian or American? Serbian or English?
Serbian for me, obviously, Chicken Kolo. You know, because
Of course.
I still can't believe I'm still playing it today. It's been, you know, it's been over 50 years, and it's just, you know, it's dear to me. Of course, you know, when I told my kids, when I die, make sure you throw a pair of drumsticks and a CD in my coffin with the Chicken Kolo on there, man, so I could take it to heaven, hopefully with me if I can go to heaven.
Wait, real quick, how did the name come? Chicken. How'd you name it Chicken again? For those that just joined us.
I don't know.
Yeah, because, you know, remember we said how the kids were bouncing up and down?
Oh, yeah.
Dancing so fast. If you looked at it from stage, you just looked like, you know, chickens kind of pluck their arms, and you're kind of bouncing up and down with the colo.
Who came up with that?
That's what it looked like. Oh, boy, that's a good question. I don't know, man, how that just came out with chicken.
All right.
Yeah.
Nick?
I don't know how that came out with it.
Because it came before Nick, obviously, because we were playing it, you know. Yeah.
Well, I mean, okay, what songs do you not want to play or do you not like playing? Or during, you know, at that time, as Mlada Srbadija?
No, I did love Chicken. I I really enjoyed the parts where at the very beginning of, like, let's say a wedding or something, where we did the songs. We would sing during the dinner rather than playing boom boom music.
Yeah.
You know, kind of cooled it down. And you know, we would do like Tozovat stuff and two, three part harmonies. And you know, when we did some of the rock stuff, and you know, Vinko had the high voice and Tommy had the low, and I was in between. We, you know, I kind of did, you know, that was putting it all together, get the vocals and the music was
well for me. My favorite. For me, Spaz, I just, as a drummer, you know, just I'll be selfish. I didn't like playing the slow regular 2/4 beats, just the songs and the pestles, because it was just boring for me. I mean, I know people liked it, we had to do it, but for me, I just like, okay, let's get on with this, man. You know,
so. Tell me something about this picture. I'm gonna put it up on the screen right there. When is that from?
Oh yeah, so this is South Chicago, Saint Simeon, 114th. I want to say, was this from the 50th anniversary? What is this from?
Like, yeah, that's, well, it's Mick, that's Mickey,
because that's Vesmar. Milan Vesmar.
Yeah,
I can't see who's on the accordion.
Ned Dusko.
I don't know. Can't tell if that's Dusko.
I guess. Yeah. Well,
but yeah, this was a picnic in South Chicago, and we were all.
We're all there. This is,
yeah, we're all here.
After we were playing, though, we weren't playing anywhere. That's Dusko.
Okay.
Got it. Yeah. And then this picture right here, that looks like a reunion picture. To tell
you. Sir. Oh, yeah.
This is 2006.
Okay.
St. Sava, Maryville, Serbfest, back still on 49th Avenue. This was actually a Mlada Srbadija reunion. We were all, my brother-in-law would come a couple times a year to visit because his mom was back here, too, with us, and he'd come a few times a year. And he'd always try to come during our surf fest because he, you know, he grew up with that, and it was good. It was really very heartwarming for him to come, you know, do this, you know, and, we said, hey, we're all going to be here. Let's show up this night and let's see if we get on stage and play a few songs.
You so. Notice how Tommy and I are ducking down in each one of those pictures. Yeah. So Vinko could be the same height. So. Oh, there he is.
And Srbadija was playing, you know, we were playing the gig. So, you know, they knew we talked to the guy, said, hey, you know, Nick and Tommy are here. Come on, play a few songs. And that's what we did. And we were accompanied by, obviously, Felix and of course, Doug on guitar. And Georgie Runio, at the time, I Coombe George, he took a break because he was playing bass and gave it up to Nick. And we had a little reunion there. It was a lot of fun. A lot of people came out that night because we had advertised it that it was going to be a thing. And there was a lot of people standing around watching it and dancing, for sure, man.
There are a lot of memories. You know,
a lot of memories. Yeah, absolutely.
That's a big thing, right? So,
absolutely.
And what we have is video of that. And I'd like to go ahead and play a little bit of that from the reunion.
First, right? I'd like to thank, for who did this for us, Mike and Dorothy Ponovich. Also, Dorothy, a big, big shout out to Dorothy. She's the one who put all these pictures together. After I got them to her, she was able to scan them and took the time to put them in chronological order. So, Dorothy, God bless you. We love you. Thanks for doing that for us. And then Mikey's son, Mike and Dorothy's son, was a photographer. He does film and stuff like that. So he came out with this camera, and he's the one that made this video for us. So thank you very much for that.
So that was the intro to this video. It was a reunion. What year? 2006? Is that what we
2006,
said?
2006, yes.
2006, St. Sava Festival. Enjoy it, and we'll be back. Oh, that hat.
Hey, Mr. Gerbic, God bless him.
Gordon, right? Gordon Gerbic?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
God, again, these names to me are legendary, you know?
Amen, brother.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mlada Srbadija. Za vas. Yo, I harmonica.
The passion, man. The reunion, yeah. Maleva, you're in this video. You're my boy.
Mlada Srbadija reunion 2006. Hi there, youth. Did all of you guys sing?
Yes.
And was Tommy typically the lead singer while you guys were playing?
That's correct. Tommy was the lead singer for the Serbian music. Absolutely. Yep.
If you just join us, the Mlada Srbadija 2006, I could say mini reunion here, huh?
Yeah, buddy.
Pink, while they're playing, did you ever play any other instrument other than the drums?
Nope, just the drums.
Just the drums from day one, huh?
Day one, that's it.
What about Tommy? Anything else other than the accordion?
Organ.
Yeah, keyboards. Yeah. Oh.
Look at that emotion. It's just amazing.
You can see the passion. I'm telling you, brother.
I think it's so awesome. I see Dusko Trajković back there in the corner. Yeah. Alex Tulovic from Shmadia Dog. A couple of reinforcements there. Uh-huh. We'll come back to that video right there in a minute. So
cool.
All right, so Mlada Srbadija plays. Tell me what happens and how does it slowly, come to an end, right? You ended about what year was the ending of Mlada Srbadija?
In the fall of 78.
The fall of 78.
Yes. Yeah.
So let's. How does that come about?
Can I go back to 77? Because it's a very important story, man.
I'm waiting.
How much this meant to me and. You know, the love I have for Serbian music, and I'm so grateful that I was exposed to this and had the opportunity to do this because of this too, I was able to meet my wife. So this is a great story. I got to tell this story because I just have to. So
of course.
It's August of 77. So I moved back, remember I told you I moved back in 76, and Sonia and I started dating shortly after I come back, and we kind of knew eventually, that things were happening, and we said, okay, well, we're probably going to get married. This is going to happen in a couple months. We get booked for the SNF basketball tournament at St. Sava, August of 77.
Okay.
A couple months before.
Were the tournaments as big? They were as big back then as they were today. Yes.
Oh yeah.
Always. Oh, yeah. A big deal, right?
Big deal. SNF, yeah, they were big. Both sides with the diocese sign and the SNF, they were all these gigs were big, huge, no doubt. So we go, we're going to get engaged. We're going to go pick out the ring. Sonia and I go pick out the ring. And we don't know when it's going to be ready, this and that. So time goes on, and now we're playing for this gig in August at the SNF basketball tournament. I get a call that week, a couple of days before the jewelry call store calls and says, the ring is ready. I said, okay. So I go pick it up. This is great. So I'm dropping hints, this and that, and, you know, talking to all her friends, and we're playing at the basketball tournament. It's the first set. We're taking a break. I yell to Sonia on the microphone, Sonia, I got to talk to you. Outside, we got to go outside, you know, during the break. So we run outside. She's kind of crying, kind of maybe already kind of anticipating, knowing that, you know, this is going to probably happen. And all her girlfriends and shit stuff are standing by the door, by the front door. They were running out to the parking lot. So most romantic thing ever, I proposed to my wife in my green pickup truck right there during the break in a hot summer day, opened the door right there and just asked her to marry her. And here I did it at a golf tournament in the St. Sava parking lot. That's why it's so dear to me that how important St. Sava was to me too, growing up and being exposed to this. I was able to meet my wife, and we got engaged during the SNF basketball tournament in 77. So there you go.
That's a very important piece of this puzzle, isn't it?
Yeah, buddy.
That's, you know, yeah. I met my wife because I was playing with Mlada Srbadija.
Mm-hmm, that's
she
right.
She was from the other side, and it was... it was, you know, love at first sight, I think. It did last quite a long time, 39 years. But she was,
Remember, I told you we kicked off our friendship, hit it off right away. Nick is my coom. I asked him to be coom for our wedding. So Nick is coom to me and coom to my kids. So him and, well, you know, obviously Kathy too, you know, yeah. Coomovie. But so yeah, then he's my coom.
I was coom for Tommy's wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And Kathy and I were coom for Tommy's oldest son, first son.
Mm-hmm.
And wasn't Ned somehow involved with your family? Was he related to a cousin?
Oh yeah, Ned Pakrites married my first cousin.
So
I think that's where all in the family.
Pardon me?
All in the family.
All in the family, yeah.
I think that's where the album Coomovie got its name.
Yeah, they say we're all Coomovie eventually somehow. So right? Down the line, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Miko, I have a request for you to talk about how you potentially faked a medical condition at the bowling tournament in St. Louis. Any info on that?
Fake the medical condition? Insane.
I'm just telling you what I got as the information.
Wow.
Well, it's fine. We don't have to make it public.
Fake the medical condition. I have to think about that, man.
While you're thinking about that, tell me, you guys traveled often, right? You just left St. Louis. Yeah. You traveled outside of the Chicago metropolitan area?
Absolutely.
How far did you get?
We played everywhere from, you know, Missouri, Wisconsin, Michigan, Ohio, and Canada,
yeah,
for sure. That was probably the gist.
Like Windsor, Hamilton, Toronto. Yeah.
Yes. And then Detroit, you know, Cleveland, Akron, St. Louis quite a bit, Milwaukee quite a bit, and all over Chicago, obviously, all Illinois, and then, of course, all of Indiana, you know. And it was not uncommon for us, you know, again, as the popularity got stronger, we were just getting gigs, just crazy stuff. I mean, remember, we're all young too, so we're real stupid. We would play, you know, we'd play Friday night in St. Louis, Saturday night we'd play in, you know, Indianapolis, Sunday night we're coming back to play South Chicago Picnic. So I mean, that was like, you know, that's yeah.
I don't think that's stupid. I think that's, you know,
that's how we were. It was kind of a normal thing for us.
But, it was like, yeah, you'll be in Akron on Friday, you'll be in St. Louis on Saturday, and then you'll be in Cleveland on Sunday, and to be at work on Monday.
Yeah.
Did you guys make it to work?
Yeah, we were
sure you did.
Strong kids, man.
No, yeah, we did.
Yeah. Oh, our man, my tata made sure. Hey, you're gonna do this. You're gonna get up and go to work, man. So.
So now, as we you get married, Chastitham, congratulations.
Thank you.
We go into the last chapter of Mlada Srbadija. How does that come about?
You know, we're all, you know, obviously we're all getting older. We're getting careers, you know, career orientated, people going in different directions. And it was time to move on.
I think it was when you and Sonia and Ned all moved to Arizona.
Well, yeah. Well, the Arizona thing. Yeah. Because Ned got a job in Arizona. Mm-hmm. So we were on our way. Well, first of all, I got to say that my mother-in-law got remarried and moved to California.
Okay.
So that came later on. And then, you know, as we were deciding that it was time to like maybe wind this down, because Ned had got an opportunity to with an engineering firm in Arizona. We Sonia and I just got married too. We're like, well, it's just gonna start fading out. Let's just see what's gonna happen here. Maybe we should go out west too. And her mom had called and said, maybe she kids should move to California too. There's nothing holding you back, blah blah blah. And Nick, I can't remember, you were into the restaurant business pretty heavy, so. Yeah, we just felt it was time. Our brother-in-law wanted to move to California too, to work for my stepfather-in-law at the time. He was a contractor out there, who's also a famous tambora player. So that's kind of what happened. We knew by the fall that, you know, we need to start winding down and not take any more gigs, you know.
Have now at this time, toward the end, you know, 76, 7, 78, were there other bands that popping up? I think Soko. Yes. And maybe, was it Mlados that began, from what I remember from the interview?
Mlados came on strong. They were probably the ones that really were working at filling in. Soko was there. They were with us, and they were...
Yeah, Soko came out. I got a 1977.
Okay.
So Soko, yeah, came out like gangbusters too, and basically just carried on the same drive that we had offered to. And they, you know, great musicians. They knew what to do, fit right in. It was a perfect thing for them just to come along. You know, they were a couple of years behind us because they were younger, but yeah, they rocked it, man. So you had Soko going on, you had Mlados going on. I can't remember some of the other bands. Well, Avila was out in Wisconsin.
Right, right. You know, and it seems always that when we talk about any Milwaukee-based bands, it seems like they were so far away that they were in their own bubble.
They were. And Avila was their kids of the original Avila group. They were playing by the 70s.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. So
but we still had our jobs. We played in Las Vegas. We got together for a job in Vegas. We did a wedding in where? King City, California.
California, yeah.
California. Yeah. So, you know, we'd have these reunions every once in a while.
So Mlados and Soko start picking up events. What, I mean, would you say that, what events did you mostly play? I know you played all the big tournaments and the Zabavas and whatnot, but were there a lot of weddings? Were there a lot of christenings? Were there a lot of graduation parties, birthdays? Yes. Were those also back then?
All the graduation parties.
All the graduation parties.
We would play Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. I mean, that during graduation time, everybody had a different night for the graduation party. They usually had it at the church hall, and we would play. We'd leave our instruments there all week long.
Yes, Spaz. I could tell you one year for sure when that. You're a good point, Nick. When we were doing heavy duty with the rock and roll stuff too, it was the kids went to their parents and said, "Listen, we got to have Srbadija play for my graduation party." That was like a normal thing. So, sure. And there was a small hall on 49th Avenue. Off to the left there, that's where all the graduation parties were held. If you were like for all the kids from St. Sava, for example, mm-hmm. and to Nick's point, seriously, we would be booked like on Wednesday night, there'd be a party, graduation party, Thursday night, graduation party, Friday night, graduation party, Saturday night, graduation party. We just leave our instruments there. Each night it was a different family's graduation party. That wasn't uncommon. That was like a normal thing for us, man.
And plus you have to realize back then there was a Zabava somewhere every Saturday night.
Yeah.
Sometimes every Sunday night. And there was always a picnic. You know, that was a given.
Was there multiple like Zabavas going on at the same time? Or you're like,
yeah.
All right, so who would play at the other ones? Would it be like a tambora?
Soko would play or
towards the end, right?
Towards the end. Yeah. But earlier on, you still had, you know, the Momo Rankovic and a few other guys, you know, hanging out here and there. But yeah, there was, you know, Zabavas here and there. That's why people would always make sure with the advertising. Where was Srbadija playing? You know, hopefully they were in town, because a lot of times too, you mentioned we had a lot of weddings. We were booked for weddings like a year in advance. Right. We'd go to St. Louis for a wedding, and we'd go to Detroit for a wedding. It wasn't uncommon. So
right,
yeah, Indianapolis. Indianapolis booked us a lot. Every time they had something down there, we were booked solid. So it was
So you guys kind of said, okay, we're leaving, we're doing, what was the last event of Mlada Srbadija?
Cool. That's a good question. I wonder if I have it in that book, but I don't know. Do you remember the last gig, Nick? If it was a wedding or if it was a regular gig?
It was at St. Sabas.
It was at St. Sabas?
Yeah, I remember that because we were all kind of like, you know, just hugging and, you know.
I could probably look it up in our booking book, Spaz, if I grab it real quick. But I want to say it was probably St. Sabas, you know.
Okay. Yeah. We have a question out there, and it says, what about the guys from Harbor Sherville, George Uzelets, Mia Stoiko?
Oh, yeah, George and them guys. They were younger, young guys, and they were coming up good. Yeah.
So there was another band that was coming up at the same
time. Right. Yes, right. Yes.
Okay.
These guys were so much younger. Yeah, I forgot about these guys because they were so young, man.
Hey, follow Yovo. Yovo sent that one.
Yeah, Dragon. Dragon. Yep.
They were probably the same age as you guys were when you started, right? Like mid-teens?
Correct.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
Okay. So you guys come to an end. You're saying we're going to California, but something doesn't stop. Both of you continue to play. Nick Jarrett continues to play with Tambora Bands, right?
Right.
Almost as a freelancer, from what I understand, right, Nick?
Well, I did. Started as a freelancer, yeah, but then got in with the Medich brothers, which kind of fit us good. You know, my wife was a Medich, and from South Bend, like, you know, those guys. And Wayne Asilovich and I played together back in the original St. Sava group.
Wayne, let me ask you a question. Is that the guy who ran for mayor at Crown Point many years ago?
Yes, it was.
That's what I thought. Yes. I heard these names. See that?
I didn't know that, man.
Yeah.
It was like mid-90s or late 90s, I think.
Guy's got a fantastic voice. And the knowledge of Tambora, like, I mean, he's probably the best. Wayne, I'm not blowing smoke up you anyway, but he's probably the best tamborash, or one of the top tamborash in the country. It's fantastic.
And Vinko, you packed up your bags and you head out west to California.
Yeah, buddy, in the middle of winter too, 1979. Sold. We didn't expect to sell the house that fast, and we put it on the market and it sold like so fast. We had to get out, so we moved, and that was it. So we already knew. I was already in touch with. So the original thing was my brother-in-law. We were going to play, me and Tommy, and then there was Alex Knezovich, who was the famous accordion player from the original Shamadia band out of Milwaukee, which it was already out there too. And then Voykan Karan, who was the guitar player from the original, they were already in California. So we hooked up right away. It was a no brainer. It was just like nobody ever took a beat, a rest. We started playing right away, you know, getting the material together. And we already had one of the Serbian churches already hired us for New Year's Eve. We already had a gig lined up, and that was the original. That was Kumovi, was that band. And it just,
Orchestra Kumovi, that's out of Southern California, out of the L.A. area, Los Angeles.
Correct. That's
right?
Correct. Yep.
So Vinko goes to L.A. Mr. Trilo goes back to Branco's Pizza and the restaurant establishments and continues to play with the Medich brothers and whatnot. And Kumovi, Mlada Srbadija pretty much comes to an end at this.
Correct. Right. Yeah.
So, you know, we're going to, as our series of local bands continue, I'm hoping to talk to Soko, Orchestra Soko, soon enough, and because they then come in at this time period, yes. Right? Talked to Mlada already, and they pretty much pick up a lot of it.
Oh, yeah.
They become, from what I understand, the cream of the crop.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's correct. Absolutely.
And I'm very excited to hear that conversation as well. And then, Vinko, you wind up moving back into the area when? When do you come back to the metropolitan area?
1993. So from 1980 to 1993, I was in California, but never stopped playing. We had Kumovi for not all the years, but most of the years, you know, Kumovi was rocking. We were the band in California for sure.
And then you come back here and you still continue to play.
Yeah. Yes.
What do you hook up with now?
I hook up with Alex, man. Chica Felix. I'm trying to remember how that started, but
he was with Soko.
No, that was Soko was already broke up too. But this is 1993, Nick.
I know, but
he was playing.
He played with Soko before.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Alex. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I got the date at the first meeting I had. They ended January 1st, 1987, after Nova Godina.
There you go.
That event ended. It was great that he gave me that info. I needed that, right? So, they finished in 87, Soko, right? So, but when did Soko would start? When do you think, when did Soko start? Remember?
1977.
Yeah. They had a 10-year run.
Yep.
Wow. Okay, so you're back, and you now continue to play with Srbadija. Is that correct, Minko?
That's correct.
Nick, what's your story? Who do you play with now? Or are you still a freelancer?
I'll still fill in once in a while with somebody, but yeah, I'm not in a regular group at all.
Minko, were you going to say something?
No.
I was just clearing my throat, sorry.
It's all good. So let me get some info. So for all of you that don't know Vinko Amančić, Vinko has two children, Daniela and Tony, and married to his beautiful wife, Sonia, for 42 years, I hear. Is that correct?
Yeah, buddy. Yeah,
congratulations.
Thank you.
Nick, you have three beautiful daughters, Daniela, Angela, and Katia.
Correct.
And you were married 39 years before your wife passed away. 39, 42. Those are amazing numbers, guys.
Thank you.
Tommy has four children, right?
Yes.
Nick, Mitchell, Christina, and Jacqueline, right?
Yes.
And where does Tommy live nowadays?
In Southern California, Pasadena.
Is he still playing or no?
No, he don't play. You know, he might pick up the accordion once in a while just to dust it off. But he has a tunnel and sewer construction company in Southern California.
Oh, wow.
So he's busy with that and still loves the music. I mean, that'll never leave his heart. He's very passionate, you know.
Sure. Well, I see it in the video.
Yeah, buddy.
I mean, really. It's
awesome. He was always like that from day one, man. So
it's awesome. And tell me, what happened to Ned Pokrajec, please?
So Ned Pokrajec, another sad story we have to share. So I want to make sure I got the date right. In fact, I think I remember the time when we got the phone call. We were actually playing for the bowling tournament in Cudahy, Wisconsin, 1997. And we're in the hotel room, and the phone rings, my wife and I, and we get the phone call that Ned Pokrajec was killed in a car accident. So that happened to our dear friend Ned. Very sad.
Did he have any children? Do you remember offhand?
I believe he had a son, yes.
So, Vyachnaya Pamyat to Norman. And never to be forgotten memory eternal.
Yes.
Now, guys, what do you guys do in your free time nowadays? Free time?
Yikes. Well, I'm still playing. Like I said, we play whenever we get this. This year has been kind of a shot because of the pandemic stuff. But
never mind my question.
Yep. Still playing and just busy working with both of my kids to try to make sure everything is okay there. They're both in some little venture things they got going on. I try to help out as much as I can and, you know, stay busy.
And you're active at the parish. So
they're very active at the church and with Lifeline. And so that's kind of what I'm doing. I'm still trying to stay as active in music as I can until they take these drumsticks out of my dead hands, man. You know, they got to pry them out of my dead hands, as the saying goes.
Rilo, what are you up to nowadays?
Well, I'm still trying to open up another restaurant.
Nika na dosta, try.
No, nije dosta. I mean, I'm too young. You know, you got to keep working. I do want to travel more. This pandemic really kind of goofed things up. I've been going back to Europe sometimes twice a year. And I kind of miss it. I'd like to do more of it. And Vinko and I are going to make a road trip as soon as the pandemic's over. We're going to actually drive to Vegas. That's one of our...
In an RV, man. We're going to rent an RV and drive there, man. Like two studies, man.
We're on a mission from God to do this. Get our band together and move.
So I'm going to pull back up on the screen the reunion of 2006 where you guys played. And just play a few more minutes, and we'll come back with some closing remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mlada Srbadija. Za vas. Thank you. Was this a common song back then, guys?
Yes. Thanks, Kuma.
Hey, Danica.
Thank you. Talk about that, yo. Thanks. Tony right there in the background.
Not a yoga.
What was the most requested song when you guys were playing back in the day? Do you remember?
Chicken. Chicken without yeah. No second guessing. Yeah.
Tell me, guys, how close were you to the original sound when it came to reunion time? Would you say you were pretty much there?
You know what? We played a job in Las Vegas. We hadn't played in, what, 3 years?
Yeah, probably.
And we just got up there on stage and just Tommy said, okay, we'll play this song. And we started. It was just like we...
It was like you never stopped.
It was, yeah. We kind of looked at each other. Like,
not even a little
wow.
bit slower? Not even a little bit slower?
Not even a mistake. And Vinko didn't even have drumsticks. We had two dowel rods that we had to buy at a Kmart.
My bag disappeared. Yeah. But yeah, this getting back to this, Baz, this is pretty much close to the, just like it was, man. Yeah.
Amazing. Mlada Srbadija, 1969 to 1970.
8.
Right, Danny.
All right, that was from the reunion 2006, ladies and gentlemen. Amiga. How sweet a bato.
Oh, yeah.
And you see the smile, you know?
Now, what you're seeing, so you mentioned that smile. So that, think about when we played when we were kids, how, I mean, the passion and the energy that we had. It just, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to tell you, man. It was just, we loved it so much. And then, we fed off the energy from all the kids that were dancing, Spaz. You know what I mean? It just came back to us. I don't know how to explain it, man. That's why I think Mlada Srbadija just had that, whatever word you want to use, you know.
You're never tired.
Yeah, we were never tired. We never not enjoyed playing. You know what I mean? We didn't have any bad gigs. It was just so much fun. And you could tell with our gift of music, we made all these people happy, and it came back to us, man. It made us play even better because we saw the energy and the passion from looking down at the dance floor from the people. You know what I mean? It's just, God, I can't explain it, man.
No, you don't have to. I get it.
Yeah.
Well, you have left another generation of memories. You carry the baton. You started what's considered boom, boom.
Yeah, boom, for sure, man.
That boom, boom sound, right?
Well, I'd like to add, too, I know we're talking about, like, for closing comments, we have to finish up here, but, you know, we played songs like Adriano, for example, you know, we would interact with the crowd. So you're dancing the first 10, 12, 15 people that were in line that, you know, started the colo. We each verse, we'd say, you know, whoever was in that line, we would say their name and sing a whole verse with their name. You know what I mean? It was so cool. People love, they look up at you and just waving and smiling, you know, and instead of just saying Adriano, the next verse would be Nikki, you know, so-and-so, you know, Dorothy, you know, just on and on and on. That's what we did. We interacted with the crowd, like, so much. And I got to point this out, too. Back in the day, it was, if you started a Ushest and you were leading the colo, you, like, led the colo.
Nobody broke in.
There wasn't like, let's start this over here. That was like an honor system. So, you know, somebody would Peter Mullen, for example, you know, people like, they start the colo. That was it, man. You go and they led the colo. That was like an automatic thing. So you had to follow in.
When did that change where people were doing their own thing later?
Oh, boy, I don't know. It stayed with Srbadija, so I can't answer it. It had to happen after Srbadija, you know. So.
But if you came back to play with Srbadija, was that the case?
With Srbadija?
Yeah. When you came back, did you already see separate colos starting?
Oh yeah, yeah. That was done. Yeah.
So somewhere in the '80s then.
So, okay, but yeah,
when
man.
We played, it was one head of the snake because that was it.
Yeah.
And that led all over the place.
And when we played chicken, you better be prepared because the colo would last anywhere from 20 to 30 minutes. I mean, normal. I mean, that was 30 minute was about. We had guys like Slavko Tomic, you know, from South Chicago. This guy, you talk about somebody passionate dancing. You know, I mean, this kid was just—he was the real deal. So people like that, man.
His name's come up in a few conversations. I didn't realize he was that active and that passionate.
Oh yeah,
he was the original break dancer.
Oh yeah,
he did it to Serbian music.
He had his own moves. So people would say, because the way he did the Ushest, the steps that he added, we would actually say from the stage, "Hey, everybody, let's do the Slavko." You know, so he had his own thing where he added his extra pieces and stuff like that. Very cool, man. Yeah.
Any final words for everybody that has joined us this evening? Any final thoughts? Nick, Mr. Trilo, would you be mind starting? Anything you want to say to all these people that will be watching, if not with us tonight, but in the future? I'm very happy and thankful that you guys have allowed me to do this interview.
Thank you for doing this.
It's a great way to leave another memory, digital.
Well, I myself am very happy that you gave us this venue. I loved the music, played it a lot. My regret is we never recorded professionally anything for the Mlada Srbadija group. But to the people that have seen this, and even the younger generations, mainly the younger generations, pick up an instrument, start playing, and just keep going. I'd like to see this go on another generation or two or three or 10.
Goes in circles, yeah.
We have something that a lot of people don't have.
Right.
And to keep this, our music, be an American, be everything you can be as an American, but also remember where you came from. And the Serbian music is a big part of it. So,
thank you, Mr. Trilo.
There's a baton to you. Go with it.
Okay.
Nico, sir.
Well, again, too, Spaz, thank you for doing this. When you started this, you know, a few months ago when this all happened with the pandemic, this, you were right on target with this. So God bless you for doing this.
Wow.
And thank you for allowing us to be part of this and share this. I think it was needed. It's nice to know, you know, how we went back and you know, everybody could see, because, you know, the kids nowadays, they didn't know like all this. Their parents could tell them whatever, right?
Including
you. So this is great. And thank you for doing this. It really means a lot. You're a super dude, man, for doing this. I would like to say, you know, for me personally, to all the musicians I played with, I can't tell you, I've been blessed from day one with my brother-in-law on the accordion and all the other accordion players I have played with over the years, and the musicians, the bass players, the guitar players. I can't thank you guys enough. You know, I've been real fortunate to play with all good accordion players, all the way down from, you know, my brother-in-law, Alex Julevich, and Alex Knezovich, you know, I mean, just Nick Brodkovich. Oh my God. Nick on bass, my Coom George on bass, you know, and all the guitar players, Doug, and everybody had just been blessed with really, really good musicians. Well, I don't know what to say. I'm glad this happened in my life, and I was able to meet my wife, and I have my two beautiful children through this, and all because of the Serbian music. I probably never would have met her, so, you know, I'm very grateful for that. I thank the Lord every day for that too. And I got the best Coom ever right here, and continue to play, and as long as we could keep making people happy, and chickens over 50 years now. So, you know, what do you say with that? I mean, what else could you say? You know, with, you know, right? It's funny how in music that a song like that could last this long and still have that same stigma, right? From 50 years ago. It's like never changed. Yeah.
Thank God. That means there's something there, right?
Yes.
Again, I came many years later, right?
Yes.
And I am completely psyched about learning Serbian music history and the scene and what it was like growing up. You know, and I'm familiar with the tambura, and tambura is still so dominant in certain circles here, right? In certain cities. And to see this boom boom band sound come alive and where it came from. Remember, Mlada Srbadija to me was, okay, Mlada Srbadija, neki band. Okay.
Yeah.
And you hear it, you know, talking to people that I am just, you know, honored to be friends with, you know. You know, I don't know if you tuned into the Mladost interview, Vinko.
Yes, I did, yeah.
Bobby Bulatovic of Mladost, you know, Jan of Soko, you know, mentioned you. You were his inspiration. You were his probably mentor, you know, and I just wanted to make sure that people understand that and people are aware of that. And because he's another fine musician here.
Oh, yeah. Very. Yep. Yep. Thanks, Bobby. I appreciate that, man.
Hvala vama for taking the time out to speak with us. Hvala vama for letting so many people go back in time. It's been an enjoyable evening, as far as I'm concerned.
Me and too.
It's as if I were in a time capsule.
That's cool. I'm glad it worked out good too. So yeah, we were able to work it out with the music. What are we going to finish with tonight, Spaz? You got a surprise for us, man?
The legendary. It would only be right to play it, wouldn't it?
Absolutely.
Chicken Colo.
I got to apologize now too before we get into the song. So remember, this was somebody put this cassette player on the stage,
and
for some whatever reason, you know, 7-8 minutes into the song, it gets cut off. Somebody hits the stop button. So you're not going to hear the whole true thing of the super ass, you know, nice ending and stuff, but you're going to still get the gist of it and the nice intro on it too. Thanking our friends in St. Louis, you know? Yeah. So anyway, I just wanted to preface that. So in case people were expecting a big explosion on the end there. So,
well, at least we didn't have time for 30 minutes.
Exactly. Yeah. That too.
Guys, laku noć, hvala vam, želim vam sve najbolje u životu. May you and your families be blessed. And thank you od srca, znači, as a first generation Serb born in the late 70s here, whose grandparents immigrated to this country, and parents, hvala vam od srca. Živi bili I živili
Follow that ball to you, Spastu. Thank you very much for doing this. God bless you.
Hvala mama. Guys, ladies and gentlemen, I got to stop saying that. Prijatelji moji, it is time for the infamous chicken call.
Everybody drop. Let's go. Get to dancing.
We'd like to dedicate this first song to the number one man in St. Louis, Patsy. Yay. Where's he at? Is he out there? Oh,
that's
hey.
A couple that she's talking
hey,
about.
Patsy for taking care of him. The band when they come down to St. Louis. Patsy, this chef Cole for you, brother. Ow!
Is that you being screaming?
That's me, man.
Man, it takes you forever to start this, huh?
We had to make sure the leader was on the floor, man.
Yeah.
Thanks, Patsy.
There's the staff.
Mlada Srbadija, 1969 to 1978.
Thanks, Thanks, come on. Come on, Dorothy.
What do we say, 1976, right?
That's right.
That's right. Here we go. Oh, yeah.
Oh man, probably Jimmy, yeah.
Mlada Srbadija. Oh yeah. Thank you. Let's get a side profile, just like the Beatles. Here we go.
That's pizza, buddy. Yeah, buddy.
When did they go 1, 2, 3, 4, hit the floor? When was all that added in? You know, Mikko?
Oh, that was added in.
Many years later?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, yes, yes, here we go.
No. CKO of you rock, buddy. Exactly.
Prijatelji moji, Mlada Srbadija.
Yo.
And that's how it ended, just like that. Boom. Nick, Vinko, Laku noć.
Laku noć.
Doviđenja. And good night.
Good night, Spaz. Thank you. God bless you again. Once Hvala. Again, thank you so much.
Veliki pozdrav. We're going to end with one more. How about that? As a bonus.
Sure, why not?
It's a toast of its one. You should know it. Šta je život? And that is a great question to ask, huh? Lako noć, živi bili momci.
Thank you, Sonia.
Come on, march down, brother.
Oh, cool, but that's awesome.
Mlada Srbadija.
I'm gonna make you mine.